Reality shows are extremely fake. Crying, screaming, fighting, the normal things to have in these shows, correct? But what if I told you they were real this time? And the cast? Literal children, between 8 and 15 years old. Now, if I told you that people enjoyed the book Lord of the Flies, you wouldn't be very surprised, would you? I mean, it's one of the most famous books of all time and was written by a Nobel Prize-winning author. But one man seemed to love it a little too much. His name? Jonathan Karsh. Born on October 16th of 1971, he became an executive film producer. I would love to be able to tell you more about this immaculate specimen, but all you find when looking for Jonathan Karsh's life is 13 facts about his birthday, and then more facts about his birthday, and then the day he was born, and his birthday. In 2003, however, Jonathan Karsh won the 2003 Sundance Film Festival Best Director Award for the documentary My Flesh and Blood. After a pretty stagnant few years, in 2007, Jonathan Karsh would host the most controversial reality show of the time. During the screening for TV reviewers, producer Tom Foreman acknowledged that, and I quote, Kid Nation would inevitably share some elements with William Golding's novel Lord of the Flies, the book where they literally kill the fat kid. And then, on September 19th of 2007, this show follows 40 kids that are bussed in like soldiers, packed heavily into one school bus with all of their belongings. Once they are herded off the bus like sheep, Jonathan makes it very apparent to these, once again, literal children, that they are completely alone here in the middle of nowhere. They are actually in the former Bonanza City, New Mexico, which has now become a movie set and is the exact same place as the tragic incident during the filming of the movie Rust. They are given their food, animals, and other necessities in huge crates on wagons that they are forced to pull all the way to the actual quote-unquote ghost town. Right out of the gate, there is fighting between this guy Greg and this guy Mike. But that's not it. DK over here ends up cramping and collapsing halfway through. They finally arrive in the town and, well, everything should be good from here, right? I mean, they're in the town, they have all of their necessities, everything should go great, right? Wrong. Their mattresses are packed into small containers and are the thickness of a blanket, which means that they are forced to sleep on these probably splintery wood floors that have gaps in the boards, with blankets that are, according to Jimmy, the thickness of a carpet. They don't even get a pillow. And then, dinner. The children are forced to do everything on their own, and, well, I mean, they're children. They put pasta into the pot before it boils, and then they put so much that they can barely move the ladle through the water. But they finally make mush on a plate. The next day, the food is better, but now kids are eating all of the food and not leaving any for my main man, Jared, over here. The kids fight, Greg and Mike have another conflict, everyone shouts until Michael steps up to control everyone. Later, Jonathan Karsh reveals that his brilliant idea is setting up a caste system for the children that is decided through a giant competition. They each get paid for doing their jobs. A solid $1 in Buffalo nickels for the upper class, who don't have any specific job to do, 50 cents for the merchants who run the stores, 25 cents for the cooks who make all the food and wash the dishes, and a whopping 10 cents for the labor class, who take care of everything else. The greatest thing is that the weakest and worst group in these challenges do all the physical labor and the most amount of tasks. This town was doomed to fail from the very beginning. But there are four more kids outside of any of these groups. They are called the Council. Each one is in charge of one of the groups, and every 4 days or so, they have to pick one kid to get an award. A 2-pound gold star that's worth its weight in gold. Literally. $20,000. Now, if pitting kids against each other in a hierarchical system, making them do absolutely everything themselves, and adding the extra competition for $20,000, they have to deal with a lot more than just that. They only have one outhouse for the first few days that they are there, with a line that lasted hours and a mountain of waste piling up inside. Actual weather events that these children have to deal with on the fly, which is a literal dust storm that is knocking over their new outhouses. Multiple kids have ingested bleach throughout the show, one girl got multiple grease burns, and they could only talk to their parents right after they win the gold star on the only phone in the town. This show was insane, but it's a reality show, so it isn't real, right? Well, for that, let's turn to the statements from the actual kids in the show. JonTron did an interview with the youngest kid on the show, Jimmy, and according to him, it was almost exactly what we see on camera. But this is only one of the cast members, and it was the youngest, so he might not remember everything correctly. So let's turn to Reddit. Michael, the character that took charge in the episode, had an AMA on Reddit where he also mentioned that this show was extremely accurate to how it was shown on screen. So with this new view, we have to look at the show in a very new light. Let's take a look at some of the absolutely insane things in this show, now knowing that they are real. In episode 2, the kids were very tired of the terrible food that was being made by these children, and they decided it was time for some protein. They were planning on killing some of the chickens to finally have a balanced diet, but some of the kids didn't like this idea. They chicken-wired themselves into the chicken coop, pun intended, and were speculating on what the other people might do to their beloved chickens. And Savannah here said one of the most iconic lines of the show. This literal 10-year-old from Kentucky not only just knew about Saddam Hussein's death, but knew it only months after he was executed. Who are these children? Eventually, Greg and the others got into the chicken coop and, in front of all the other kids and camera people, beheaded the chickens and plucked them to put in a stew. They were so desperate for food that they killed their chickens and the crew let them. In the next episode, while these kids are out and about in the town doing all of their tasks, there was a huge storm that rolled in. It was enveloping the children and the camera crew, with nobody seemingly helping them. This storm was so strong that it began lifting and knocking over the outhouses. They left these kids stranded here in the middle of this storm with the camera crew just watching them. This isn't the first time the camera people just watch these kids instead of helping them. In the first episode, they film the youngest kid crying behind the house. They just film him. The anger in these kids grows and grows, and they all constantly gang up on the yellow team council leader, Taylor. Don't get me wrong, I am not defending Taylor. But when it gets to the point that she is crying multiple times an episode because she is constantly getting berated by everyone else in the town, one would assume that anyone else would intervene. Jonathan Karsh even stands right next to her and just watches everything and lets it happen. He is like a really bad teacher leaving his students behind. In episode 4, the kids start discussing religion. Many of the kids act very intolerant of other beliefs because, well, they are children. But this could be a great learning experience if there was a mature person to actually teach them about these types of situations. But once again, there is no one to intervene, and everybody else is a literal child. So instead of creating an actual learning opportunity about tolerance and other beliefs, they continue to yell and berate each other with no intervention. In episode 5, all of their pent-up anger is finally released in an explosive revolution against the council. They have a re-election after yelling at each other, and once again, the devil Jonathan Karsh just watches it all happen. I really don't understand Jonathan in the show. He is the host of the show, but all he does is announce the theme of the showdown and repeat the same line over and over again. He feels as competent in these situations as the children who have never experienced anything like this before. In episode 6, Jonathan has them dig through a giant pile of beans looking for a few cans while pigs are wriggling around. And what's their prize for completing this challenge? Fresh produce. Only now, after weeks, do they get fresh produce. In episode 7, Jared, the main man himself, creates his own shop to rival Devod's, but her crew pushed him out and he didn't like that very much. He went over and absolutely destroyed her stand in retaliation. Later, he decides to make some really cool necklaces and gets so much money that he flaunts. He ends up buying an entire new outfit and just strutting around the town. You cannot tell me that this kid isn't the greatest kid of all time. In episode 8, the showdown that they do is just an immature and idiotic idea from the crew that could have ended up leading to injury. They have to get gumballs, chew them, and color in a picture by sticking the chewed gum to it. Not even mentioning the absolute nightmare that this is looking at it now with COVID, but even then, not only is it extremely unsanitary and unhealthy for everyone involved, but there are multiple kids here with braces. For those of you who have never worn braces before, gumballs will absolutely destroy them. When the brace is loosened or broken off from the tooth, or God forbid, the wire, it will consistently cut the inside of your mouth, causing open wounds for the disgusting and unsanitary food and drink, but that's not all that was consumed. Bleach. Can you believe that? The entire crew sat around and watched the kids consume bleach. Allegedly, during a seltzer fight, DK ended up being sprayed with and consumed bleach, and he wasn't the only one. During the show, the kids had allegedly cleaned the dishes with bleach, which caused multiple kids to become sick. And while we don't know exactly what happened to them, in the words of Jimmy, you can't feel good after drinking bleach. In episode 9, they decided to mix up their teams, which many of the kids did not like. And it turned into insult wars being thrown back and forth. At this point in the show, it's not even just that the crew were just bystanders during the show, but at some points, they influenced the conflict that led to some big incidents. Taylor has a very infamous line, "Ugly chickens deserve to die." This was a huge and disgusting line that left a sour taste in everyone's mouth about Taylor, but apparently, this line was fed to her by the actual crew. Once again, don't get me wrong, I am not defending Taylor. She was a very conflict-inducing person that got my blood pressure rising quite a bit, especially when talking back to some of my favorite people like Greg, Blaine, and Michael. In episode 10, there is a very bad moment. A situation that once again could have been used as a learning experience if the crew used any intervention at all, but instead became a very bad situation. Before I play the clip, just remember, these are children that do not understand what they are doing or why it is a really bad thing to do, and aren't aware of the situations that have arisen from this behavior. And right before this, they heard another person say that these people would be so much more helpful if they just sat in the middle of the town complimenting people. Now remember all of this while I show this clip, but here we go.
So last night we heard Eric say, "I would not care if Lane BK and Greg stopped working and would have sat in the middle of the town all day and just complimented people." So I think we should really do that.
Taylor, you're looking good today.
Yeah.
Hey, yeah. Hey, Natasha, how you doing?
Hi.
You're looking good. Yeah, mamacita, yeah.
Looking nice and hot.
This was a terrible moment. God, it still makes me feel gross and uncomfortable. Now, they didn't understand what they were doing, but what could have been a very good learning experience about how this is a terrible thing to do and how insensitive and disgusting it is, the crew just watched. They kept the cameras rolling. Some of the kids here knew how terrible this was, like the amazing Sophia over here, but with the violence that has been going on in this entire episode, it immediately turned into conflict with, once again, no mediation from the crew. Make this a learning experience for the new generation instead of being focused on your ratings and engagement. Episode 11, surprisingly, was a pretty chill episode. Taylor was finally paying for her actions, but at the end of the episode, she redeems herself and good man Greg over here brings her into the arcade that he said before she couldn't access, but now because she is redeeming herself, they are all friends and nice to each other, not even holding a grudge. In episode 7, Sophia becomes the sheriff and runs the town when the council is off learning about leadership with a tribe. This is the only time in the show that they take something and make it a learning experience to help better this new generation. There are so many moments in the show that they should have taken this opportunity, but this is the only time they do so. After completing their showdown, the reward that Sophia chooses is the hot air balloon instead of the Kid Nation monument, which I understand, but it still makes me really annoyed because I would instantly go down to Bonanza just to take a photo with the Kid Nation monument. In episode 13, the season finale, the class system is burnt down and they try to stop it by throwing buckets of water, and of course, Jared helps as best he can and throws a cup of water on it. Then, they have one final showdown where they set up the entire town for a huge reunion with their parents, who are running like a stampede towards the town. Finally, they have one last council meeting where they reward three $50,000 gold stars, but Jared never gets one. How dare they? As you can see, this show was absolutely insane. CBS canceled it very soon after, not even scheduling it for a season 2, and understandably so. With everything that went down in it, some of the parents began trying to sue for what their children went through, but the amazing, and I say that in the biggest air quotes possible, amazing crew came up with their contract. Woo boy, this contract is super scummy. The New York Times ended up getting a copy of the contract, and according to them, it contained some crazy stuff. Apparently, even though the children were paid, they were not subject to any state or federal laws, meaning they could keep the children working as long as they wanted, and they didn't have to follow laws and licensing requirements for child housing. Parents had complained to the New Mexico authorities that the conditions were abusive and that several children were harmed during the production, but there wasn't much they could do as they couldn't hold the producers and CBS responsible. It was in fact so scummy that it made sure not to hold any of the producers responsible if any of the children got pregnant, contracted STDs, suffered emotional distress, received inadequate medical care, housing was unsafe, were injured, or even if they died. What's even worse is that even though the children did receive $5,000 for being on the show and had a chance to win extra money with the gold stars, if the children were to leave the show, they would lose their right to receive any of their payment. What? Are you telling me that my little Jimmy never got paid? This show is absolute insanity, and was probably not very fun for the kids to film, but at least there were some good friendships that were made from it. Apparently, during the Reddit AMA with Michael, another one of the cast members began talking on it as well. And while it would seem impossible to figure out who this was as their account was deleted and sent stuff to Michael by proxy, I have a caffeinated dual NSA FBI agent in my dorm building
with me.
Holy f-
With me, anything is possible. If we take a look at what they said, they mentioned that they were in Washington. And only three cast members in the show are from Washington. One is Michael, another is Sophie, and the last is Mike. Michael and Sophie never seem to have much of a bond, but Michael and Mike look to be seemingly good friends. But if we want to do something even more to solidify this, if we take a look at the article written by Rachel Withers on the Dirtcast podcast, we can see that there was a reunion between Mike and Michael as they reminisce on the insanity that was Kid Nation. Mike and Michael have this bond, so there is almost a certain chance that the person on this Reddit thread was, in fact, Mike.
Thanks, Emmy. Now, we know that this show was insane and terrible, but the actual show itself was really fun to watch. It's chaotic and insane, and luckily, no support is going to the terrible producers of this show by watching it, because all 13 episodes have been uploaded for free on YouTube. If you haven't watched this show, I would recommend you do so, because you will be fully invested in this madness. This show turned from a bad idea, to a terrible experience, to scummy legal issues, to now a cult classic. It's one of those shows that will always be infamous for its quality and content, just like The Room by Tommy Wiseau. It's absolutely terrible, and I love it to death. Let me know if you have any other shows you want me to take a look at, and I'll catch you in the next one.